Hi there, this is Walking and Talking. Let's talk about nothing today. Is it possible to talk about nothing? It seems completely impossible. So since you start thinking about something, since you are saying something, how it can be nothing? It's always something, but quite often it's meaningless. If you don't know what to say, if you have no idea, you just start making noise, meaningless noise. But it's also impossible if you have even a little reason or sense of what's going on. You can't say anything meaningless. So it's like, unless you are out of your mind, but you know, it seems I'm not out of my mind right now. And I can, you know, look at what I'm saying and make sense out of it. You know, sometimes it's like it sounds meaningless. I still can say, oh, look, it's meaningless. And it immediately makes sense out of meaninglessness. So whatever is going on, whatever you are talking, you can say anything about nothing. Because nothing, you may take it as a category and put in that category everything that you don't understand, that you don't know what it is. But roughly speaking, there's nothing which we can call nothing. Because whatever word you use, this word means something. And even if you use words which doesn't mean anything, like something boom boom boom. No, it's so stupid. Okay, tap. What is tap? Or pop? Or map? No, map makes sense. But yeah, even if you use these words, you can still say that, you know, they have some meaning. Yeah, and it's impossible to talk about anything meaningless. Okay, but sometimes, yeah, there's different levels of mean, and when you are, let's say, you want to talk about nothing, and there are certainly something in this theme which can be relevant to it and which can help you to understand better what is nothing, and there are something that doesn't help you. Yeah, and if it's not connected with the topic, it's less relevant to the topic, the meaning of what I'm saying is less meaning. Sounds really crazy. Yeah, the point is that all the time when you talk about anything, you may find different levels of meaning, and if your goal is talking about nothing, it seems that they are not so different. So whatever you are saying, it works, because even if you are talking about some smart stuff, like, you know, you start considering the concept of nothing, when it occurred in the history, which people were talking about, like Parmenides, who else? Some Hegels, Heideggers, you know, all these philosophers. Yeah, you may compare their understanding of the subject and, you know, probably understand it better by yourself. But, you know, it's still, when you talk about nothing, you may say, does it make sense to compare a smart talk with meaningless bullshit? Because even if it's nonsense, I guess it's much more closer to nothing than when it's something meaningful. Then, you know, there's an ideal. Yeah, maybe it's an ideal. So there is a concept which is called nihilism or nihilism, if you prefer. So in this nihilism states that everything is nothing, basically. It's oversimplification, of course. If you want to understand what is nihilism, it's better for you to, you know, to start studying it, or at least to read an article on Wikipedia. But, you know, what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to clarify my own understanding, and I need to start from really simple explanation. So everything is nothing, and you may say this is an extreme version of skepticism. So when you don't take anything seriously at all, I mean anything, whatever is going on, whatever people are talking, it's all nonsense. Everything is nonsense. Because sense is also nonsense. Okay, yeah, nihilism. And that's a pretty interesting concept. I was studying it in literature, in poetry. I wrote my own poems about the subject. But it was a long time ago. It's like, it was before I switched to English. And, you know, there was a movement in Russia at 1950s, 1960s, and in nihilism, it's usually linked with such philosophers as Friedrich Nietzsche, Søren Kierkegaard, who else? Nietzsche, Kierkegaard, who are nihilists. Okay, doesn't matter. Yeah, I probably need to think about it a little bit before saying anything. But in Russia, yeah, there was the whole movement. The whole movement related to literature and especially to Russian critics. There were a few people like Dobrolubov, Писарев, Russian critics, and they, like Писарев, I guess, was the first Russian critic who was accused being a nihilist, and the whole movement was deemed nihilism. But it wasn't nihilism per se. Turgenev wrote a book at 1862, Fathers and Sons, and in this book he presented a character, Bazarov, and this character was borrowed from a real person. There was, it's like not borrowed, it wasn't a real person, of course, but Turgenev wanted to, you know, to attack modern, at that moment, movement, and he took one of the leaders of this movement, Dobrolubov, who died at 1861, and he created a character, this Bazarov, and this Bazarov was a nihilist, basically. And then Писарев, when he became an advocate of this movement, and he said, he wrote a couple of books. First was called Bazarov, and the second Realists. And when he wrote this Realists, he was accused being a nihilist. It was actually realism. But people who tried to attack him, they called him nihilist. And basically, at that moment, it was all about fighting against aesthetics. Pisarev hated this aesthetician, and Turgenev was one of the greatest aestheticians. So it's not about, you know, his books as being considered from Pisarev's and the Dobrolubov's viewpoints. They were pure aesthetics. It's like art for art. And they believed in some social revolution,
and писарь в Добролюбов. They were socialists, and for them all literature was supposed to work for the benefits of society. And they didn't like these people who made some beauty for the beauty's sake. And yeah, and the attack was, it's like, let's destroy all this beauty and direct all energy on working with social problems. So, and yeah, this nihilist, I'm trying to talk about it. Like, I started from talking about nothing, and then I came to this point when I need to talk about nihilism. I was really interested in that when I was reading Russian literature and critics. But last few years, it seems I have forgotten all these, you know, feelings which were evoked by, you know, reading and trying to understand all this stuff. But it was profound, yeah, I guess nihilism is something really profound. And what I want to do is now is talk more about nothing, nihilism, and see how can I understand it better. It's like, it's about understanding. I'm trying to build some concept, and basically my concept, which now what I want, just 12 minutes, I'm going to go back on, like, going on the railroad, yeah. So basically my concept is that empty talks or talks about nothing are extremely important when you are studying a foreign language. So if you want to be good at foreign language, what you need to do is not just memorizing grammar, structures, and different words. You just need to do lots of empty talks all the time, because look at the people and their communication. Basically what they are doing, it's meaningless empty talks over and over and over again. And if you are good at empty talks, you may understand language pretty fast. Yeah, and what is empty talk? Well, again, it's like you may start from nothing all the time. It's like, let's talk about nothing. Because if you start from nothing, you don't need to worry about the meaning of your speech, of what you are saying. So what you need to worry is just, you know, how to train your brain to generate, like, sentences after sentences after sentences. Because since you started talking about something, you'll continue, unless, like, even if you, of course, if you set a certain period of time for self-talk, you'll continue unless, you know, this time is up. And it seems difficult to talk about nothing. But since you have started, at least you may talk about, you know, you may complain that there is nothing to say, and that you're talking about some meaningless things. But it still helps you to enrich your, you know, maybe not vocabulary, but your fluency. Because most of the time, again, in conversations, it's just empty talks. People don't communicate. They just, you know, share their feelings, their emotions. And empty talk helps a lot in it. Yeah. And wow. And how can you learn that? That's the question. Just talking and trying to add something to what you have said again and again. So you may start from the word. And if you look, let's suppose that you're a beginner and you can't make sentences, but you know words, and you just start to study language. You must start from, you know, like nothing, and then any word which comes to your mind, you may just say it. Like nothing, universe, for example. And then after universe, you may find another association and say whatever. Emptiness, infinity. And then when you have enough words, you may try to make like a sentence, or you may try to build some sort of meaning out of these words. Or you may just continue using these words, like association after association after association. Just practicing this exercise every day for, you know, 10 minutes, just building new associations. You'll see how far your vocabulary will grow. Okay, I think I need to stop here, because it's already, I guess, 16 minutes. And I record a new video right now. Yeah, 16 minutes.